Hello and welcome to the rebuttal video to Cowspiracy. We will be discussing our research done based on the documentary Cowspiracy that deals with the case of livestock being the number one cause of global warming as well as other major environmental issues in our world. We will be discussing vegan diets versus meat-eating diets, water usage in animal agriculture versus other industries, animal welfare, the importance of agriculture, growth hormones and antibiotic use, and what it's like being a producer. Our mission is to give you, the viewer, a new perspective on animal agriculture. Hi, I'm Cassie, and one topic that was mentioned in the movie Cowspiracy was about the choices people made regarding eating food. I feel like the movie emphasized the importance of being a vegan or vegetarian and discriminated against meat eaters. The following is one example of what physicians and nutritionists have said to be the recommended daily consumption of food. This includes eating a variety of foods such as 2 cups of fruit, 2.5 cups of vegetables, 3 cups of non-fat or low-fat dairy products, 6 ounces of whole grain bread, cereal, or pasta, and 6 ounces of lean meat, skinless poultry, fish, eggs, or nuts. Eating foods low in fat and cholesterol, eating moderate amounts of sugar, and reducing the intake of sodium or salt are other nutritional requirements as well. This is just one of the many nutritional guidelines. Every person's body is different, and depending on that, their requirements may fluctuate as well. Some of you may be wondering, since this diet seems to accommodate meat eaters more than vegetarians or vegans, then what do they substitute for the meat? Or you may have heard of fake meat, and wonder what it exactly is. Fake meat is basically a plant-based food such as soy, wheat, or corn, which is a new fungus material trending in the US. That gets manufactured into the form of a dry powder where it is then put through an extruder to reshape the molecules. It is then mixed with a type of gel such as xanthan gum that resembles a meat product. Soy molecules are globular, while protein molecules are fibrous, so reshaping the molecules is a crucial part in creating the texture for this fake meat. Regardless of which lifestyle you may choose, the USDA has a set standard of caloric intake a person should consume based on their gender and amount of mobility they achieve daily. For example, a male that is very active should consume roughly 2,400 to 3,000 calories per day, and for a female, roughly 2,000 to 2,400 calories per day. If someone is more sedentary, this would be roughly 2,000 to 2,600 calories for a male, and 1,600 to 2,000 calories for a female. These are all recommended statistics from 2010 that will vary because everyone is different with a different size, shape, and appetite. I've done research between the 3 different lifestyle choices with facts about each option. There are pros and cons to each side, whether you are a meat lover, a vegetarian, or a vegan, and whatever preference you choose to be, you can still maintain a healthy lifestyle. One pro of being a meat eater and a con for a vegetarian or vegan is that it is much easier to gain the essential amino acids one would get from meat, such as iron, B12, protein, and calcium, than would be from non-meat. Of course, all of these amino acids can be found in either plants or supplements, but being a vegetarian or vegan runs a higher risk of gaining a deficiency. This is something any vegan or vegetarian should be aware of. One pro for vegans and vegetarians and a con for meat eaters is high cholesterol, leading to heart-related diseases. Studies have shown that vegans maintain the lowest cholesterol levels overall, and that vegans and vegetarians both show a lower risk of heart-related diseases than meat eaters do, strictly from the consumption of meat. Based on these facts, you are now able to decide which lifestyle you prefer while knowing the pros and cons of each decision, helping you to live a happy, healthy life.
Cowspiracy is the water usage by animal agriculture in the United States. This documentary emphasizes the amount of water used by animal agriculture, but it does not look into the amount of water used in other industrial areas. For example, according to Cowspiracy, animal agriculture accounts for 30% of water consumption in the United States. However, with all other industrial areas, animal agriculture accounts for under 1% of water consumption, followed by mining and domestic, both at 1%, aquaculture at 2%, self-supplied industrial at 4%, public supply at 11%, irrigation at 31%, and thermoelectric power at 49%. Also, Cowspiracy claims that it takes 660 gallons of water to produce one hamburger. However, it only takes 441 gallons of water to produce 1 pound of boneless beef, although it takes over 713 gallons for the production of one cotton t-shirt, about 30,090 gallons to manufacture a car, and 36 million gallons are used in the New York City water supply system alone. Therefore, even if we do, as Cowspiracy says, and got rid of animal agriculture, we would still have water shortage issues due to all other industries using more water than animal agriculture. And if we really care about water conservation, we should stop driving cars, wearing clothes, and using water completely in our homes and businesses.
In the food manufacturing, about more than 1.4 million people are employed in the United States. In the states like Nebraska, Iowa, and Missouri, income in agriculture is very important. To fight undernourishment, have better public services, improve women nutrition, and water safety. The Animal Welfare Approved is a program that labels food products to assure consumers in the treatment of raising animals for slaughter plants. The Certified Humane Raise and Handle is a humane farm animal care. It is an international nonprofit certification organization. They have animal care standards and a committee that performs annual inspections in farms, ranches, and also slaughterhouses.
The use of antibiotics in the livestock industry, especially the beef industry, has been frowned upon for many years. Producers before the crackdown on steroids and growth hormones gave the industry a horrible image, which made many consumers weary of eating meat that was produced by the dairy and beef producers of America. Nowadays, everybody is so caught up in the past that some consumers won't even think about eating red meat. And now there are some that believe the livestock is the doer of all our problems. But now with the crackdown of the misuse of antibiotics, steroids, and growth hormones, some consumers have no problem going to the grocery store and picking up a pound of ground meat. I certainly don't believe that all major producers have gotten out of this habit, but I can tell you that the numbers are lower from previous years. The use of antibiotics these days isn't for the misuse of producing. It is used for the welfare of all the animals that are raised for human consumption. They're used for treating and preventing diseases that would prevent them from being a profitable resource to this industry. Another thing I firmly believe in is that vegetarians, people that don't eat meat at all, are the ones that push this issue all the time. I think they have no room to talk. It takes a lot to raise and keep the animals healthy that will eventually make it to your plate. Not all of us can survive on rabbit food. The world needs to eat meat to survive. People need to look more into something before they start pointing fingers and giving bad names. But anyways, the use of antibiotics, growth hormones, and steroids are regulated all throughout the meat-producing world.
My family and I have a small herd of Hereford beef cattle in upstate New York. For us, raising our own meat is one of the most rewarding feelings a farmer can ever have. As a producer, we get to watch the calves be born on the farm, be taken care of by their mothers until weaning. At weaning age, we select calves within our herd to raise for meat, and we raise them in a group together. As they get older and grow, we decide at what age and weight their carcass is most desirable. At this point, we set a date with the butcher for them to be processed. As producers, we feel that the sense this animal is giving their life to give us sustenance to move forward with our own, that they should be given the utmost respect at the time of slaughter. We have had animals slaughtered at both USDA slaughter facilities and also at local butchers. Although different, both have not let us down at any point of the process, from dispatching the animal fast and efficiently, to making certain cuts that we have asked for, and also vacuum sealing the meat into packages. For us, watching the animal go from birth to an age where it can be processed all at the hands of our care is very rewarding. And once we get to taste the fruits of our labor with friends and family gathered around, the feeling of gratification is amplified. Knowing where our meat came from, how it was taken care of, and how it was processed are all reasons we are proud to promote our beef.
We hope this video has enlightened you about these topics, as well as the negative comments Cowspiracy has against farmers and workers in the agricultural field. Our mission is for you, the viewer, to understand how important agriculture is to our world and how sometimes not all the facts are seen from both sides of an argument. Thank you for watching. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. When I was just a kid, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said, one day you'll leave this world behind. So live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights that never die. My father told me. These are the nights that never die. My father told me.